So GoPro is getting back in the drone business. It's been a hot minute since this whole hot mess here existed on the GoPro lineup, but these days they've thrown away the drones and instead focused just on cameras. And today we've got the new GoPro Bones right here. This tiny little camera weighs roughly a third the weight of the standard issue GoPro Hero 10, putting it in the same ballpark at 54 grams as something like the Action 2. The difference is though that this camera has all the same features of a GoPro Hero 10. In fact, officially it's called the GoPro Hero 10 Bones Edition. But while it has all the same resolutions and frame rates and all the goodness that you'd expect from a Hero 10, there's also a lot of things it doesn't have. For example, as you can see, it's pretty small, so it does not have a battery inside of it. It does not even have a USB connector. It's not waterproof. It only has one microphone as opposed to three microphones. It doesn't have GPS in it, so you won't get any sort of overlays as you fly along. But what it does have, though, is a huge weight savings. As I know before, it is 54 grams compared to the usual GoPro, which sits at 160 grams, so again, about a third of the weight there. And it puts it in the same ballpark as something like the DJI Action 2 that sits at 56 grams right there. And then, of course, if you want to go even lower than that, you've got something like the Insta360 Go 2, which is 26 grams, or the Insta360 SMO 4K, which basically took one of their standard action cameras and made a drone version that looks almost identical to what GoPro's done here. Of course, Insta360 was first, so in reality, GoPro looks a lot more like Insta360. And it's because of all those weight savings that you're going to be using your own drone's battery as the power source for the GoPro Hero 10 Bones Edition. Now, before we get into all the details on that, let's kind of step back a second. This is the box that it comes in. You can see right there. There we go. Move that out of the way. It's a very bare bones box. Get it? Yeah, there we go. Inside of it was the GoPro Bones Edition. Going back in time to my unboxing, you can see that there's the camera itself. There is a small cable that connects it from the camera onto your flight controller for both power as well as shutter. And then beyond that, you have a small mount there. That is a standard issue GoPro kind of mount, the two-prong mount at the bottom there, and then it connects up to the camera. So technically speaking, if you wanted to, you can get rid of that middleman mount and just go straight onto your frame, but you'd have to find a mount for that, which I'm sure over time we'll see that with various 3D printed mounts. And I'll talk about mounts in just a second. I got a couple thoughts there on that particular sort of thing. Now, as you can see, if we look at the camera itself, it's pretty slim pickings. So on the side here is where you stick your SD card slot. So right there. So this means that there is no waterproofing on this particular unit at all, which is kind of a bummer. I think, you know, one of the things that people have appreciated about putting even some of the bigger GoPros on there is that waterproofing. And many people, you do go ahead and actually waterproof their quads through basically like a spray of sorts that you put on it. That way, if it does end up in the drink or just simply due to moisture day to day, that doesn't kill your unit. And of course, in this case, GoPro hasn't said whether or not this is internally waterproofed with some sort of coating. My assumption is no, given how many warnings they put in the box, that it is not waterproofed. So anyway, just something to keep in mind there. As you can see though, on the back, there are two buttons right there. So these two buttons basically powered on and then change the modes. And you can see a small LED light at the very, very top that shows you what mode you're in. The vast majority of your setup and control will happen via either the smartphone app or QR codes. Now, of course, first we need to go ahead and get this thing wired up. It includes a very brief little description in the manual right there. You can see that pin connector. So you're gonna connect that to your flight controller and then you'll eventually reprogram that with something like Betaflight. And then you have your ground and your power being the red and black there. After that's done, you'll go ahead and plug your camera in for the first time and hope nothing like catches fire. And in my case, it did not, so that was positive. And then you see here, as I go ahead and power this on, so we'll choose that right there. If we watch the little red light there, it blinks right there. There we go. Now you saw there when it first powered on, it blinked three times and the three little lights right there means that in time warp or time lapse mode. Of course, that's not very ideal. So you're gonna go back into Betaflight and reconfigure that, invert it. And the GoPro manual has instructions on how to do that. But you have to do that first in case you haven't already done that on your drone. You can always though use these buttons to change modes. So you see right here, if I press the mode button once, it'll blink twice, which means it's in the photo mode. I press it again, it'll blink three times, which means it's in the time-lapse mode, and blink it one more time, or press it one more time, and now it's in video mode, and then I press the recording button to start recording. However, the GoPro Bones is actually the very first GoPro to use the GoPro Labs as the master firmware. If you've been around the GoPro world a while in the last couple of years, you may have seen GoPro Labs. That's basically like their beta program, if you will, for new features that eventually get trickled down into the greater GoPro subset of firmwares. Now, one of the features that's in there is a QR code option. So that allows you to take this QR code like you see right there, scan it in front of the camera, and then set the settings on this particular QR code. So in this case, if I scan this, it's gonna go to 4K 60, 4x3, color flat, et cetera. And you can create your own QR codes. They've got a little like QR code web utility if you want to. That way you can print off QR codes for whatever you want or just save them as a photo on your phone and scan them. So you'll see once I do that right here, it'll blink. There we go, boom, it blinked. So now it is set to these particular settings. And again, this is something that's been out for about 2 years now, and it works on other GoPros as well, so it's not unique to the GoPro Bones. It's just simply that the Bones has this as the master firmware as opposed to like a regular GoPro firmware, though practically speaking, that won't really matter too much to you. Now, I do wanna note there is still a microphone on the front there, and you may be saying that's why we want a microphone on a drone that just buzzes, but in reality, having a microphone there makes it way easier to sync up video after the fact, to be able to have that audio, do like an audio sync, something like that, and then you can just sync your video of your drone to all the other camera angles you may have in real life. The only difference between the Hero 10 Bones and the Hero 10 Black is this has one microphone versus three, but you don't need like the wind reduction kind of stuff on this that you would on a normal GoPro. Now, before we head outside, a couple other quick technical notes to be aware of. Obviously, as you can see, there is no USB port on this unit in any way, shape, or form, which means that you will not have automatic uploading of your content from this to the GoPro Cloud. That might not matter for you too much, but just something to keep in mind. The other big change is that there is no GPS in this either. So in order to save weight and stuff like that, there's no GPS here. For most scenarios, you probably aren't gonna use that. But if you wanted to do speed overlays or something like that with this, you can't do that. You'd have to use some other data source and then combine it in post. Okay, so here we are outside and ready to roll. Now in this case, I've got the battery plugged in, so I've got power to the drone. I've gone ahead and validated my settings using the GoPro app. You don't have to do that once you like trust things enough to know which modes it's in, but in my case, I just prefer to validate everything is exactly the way I want it for that particular flight. And also of note is that you can use a controller, of course. You can program this using Betaflight to control this, so it controls the camera and turns it on and off. Personally though, I just like to know that it's in the setting mode that it's in the entire time from the moment I leave it alone. So I'm just simply using the GoPro app and the buttons on this so that I like visually know it's either on at the start of the flight or off and just leave it that way for the entire flight. After that, you just simply get it up and start flying. Well, I've got extensive experience with other drones. FPV isn't necessarily like my strongest suit. So I'm not necessarily gonna have the most exciting footage for you here, but in many ways, this is sort of already covered ground. We know what a GoPro Hero 10 does. This is just a GoPro Hero 10 without a battery and a back screen. So we're not like breaking new ground here compared to a brand new camera or something along those lines. Now, after your flight, you got the new GoPro player with Real Steady built into it. This was released earlier this week and it's a pretty major upgrade. So I then choose to open my file up and the very first thing you're gonna notice, it says in the bottom right hand side, apply Real Steady for improved stabilization. Now for this particular clip, I did not have stabilization enabled. However, one of the big changes now for Real Steady is the fact that you no longer have to disable Hypersmooth. Up until this point, you've always had to disable Hypersmooth stabilization in order to use Real Steady, which wasn't ideal if you just wanted to grab a really quick clip on the go on your phone or something like that, and then deal with the proper edit later on. Now you can do that without sacrificing stabilization up front. Nonetheless, though, just to show you the difference between Real Steady on and Real Steady off, again, this is for a non-stabilized piece right here. I'm gonna hit play and you can see it's still pretty wobbly, moving all over the place. Now watch as I go ahead and just toggle that stabilization on. You see it expands it out and much, much smoother at this point as I make that churn. Now you can also change some of the settings if you want to. So at the very top, you have horizon leveling. The current version is not compatible with hypersmooth though. So you have to choose either horizon leveling or hypersmooth, but you can tweak the smoothest, the cropping speed, the lens correction. You can see as I change this right here, it changes that lens correction. Or I can just simply choose advanced lens and go ahead and tweak it this way instead. But again, you got lots of flexibility just like you would have in the past with Real Steady. Once you're ready to go, you go up to the top, choose file and export. And then you got even more options for exporting, including the codec that you want. So you can choose. So you can see here as I change it changes the export speed, but sacrifices quality or file size. And you can also change the bit rate down at the bottom if you'd like to as well. Once you're done, just choose next to save it. Or if you have a bunch of files, you can go into a batch queue and just simply add all those files into the queue itself and then export them all once you're ready to roll. Keep in mind, this is the first of four new cameras that GoPro has promised this year. Back about a month and a half ago on one of the shareholder calls, their CEO talked about four new cameras coming in 2022. And they talked extensively about the FPV market without necessarily connecting those two dots. And this is certainly the very first camera. But a couple quick thoughts. Number one is that the lack of waterproofing is definitely a bummer. This is the same price as a regular GoPro. So it's $399 with a new GoPro GoPro subscription or $4.99 without. So you're not really saving any money here. I guess I would have thought it'd be a little bit cheaper than a normal GoPro given the fact that it's missing some of those components. I don't know, just me. Also, given the fact that it's missing those components, I would have thought they could have thrown in a decent little mount for it. In the FPV world, you generally like either 3D print your own mounts or someone else does it for you, and you try to make it work for the frame that you have. But what you find if you do a bunch of research is that it's all over the place, and people have made all sorts of mounts that are the range between awesome and janky. And so this is something that I wish GoPro just put like a really nice little carbon fiber one in there that just was easy to use, primarily with zip ties. Some people will go ahead and screw their camera into the frame. Others will use zip ties. There's pros and cons with screws. If you crash it, it will rip the whole screw out and thread everything. That's a big mess. With zip ties, you just get a new zip tie. In my case, I've just got like a random 3D printed mount there with a zip tie, and then I'm using the front screws because that just seemed to like fit best for this particular mount onto my particular frame. So what's the like 30-second comparison between the Bones and some of these other cameras right here, or the Gep RC, Naked Hero 8, or one of those things? And I'd say the core fundamental difference is simply the resolutions and the image quality that GoPros are known for. These cameras over here all top out at 4K, versus this one here tops out at 5.3K, so you're getting effectively double the resolution of the 4K cameras, and you get all the stabilization, all the real steady aspects after the fact as well. Now, obviously, DJI and Insta360 have making inroads into the FPV market, or the build your own quad market anyways. However, I think if we look across the board, the vast majority of the time, you are seeing people just simply put a GoPro on front because of that image quality and because of that stabilization. So this option here gives you the exact same thing at one third the weight and unfortunately still effectively the same price. Of course, as always, that's the best part about choice, is that you do have choice and you do have lots of options here. Anyways, hopefully you found this interesting and useful. If so, go ahead and like that like button at the bottom there, or hit subscribe for plenty more sports technology goodness. Have a good one.